I also too, I want to recognize Captain Scott, and he's our captain over at the Bolden Area Command. Captain, if you stand up and be recognized, please. And also, he was recognized earlier as one of our state senators, but he's also one of our congressional candidates for Congress. Senator Reuben Keenan, stand up and be recognized.
Good afternoon. Thank you, Senator, for coming, and greetings from a native from New Haven. I understand you went to Yale, so
yes,
thank
sir.
You.
And you have a great haircut too, sir.
All right, thank you. Thank you. I would say you're my role model, but the ages are a little reversed, sir. Anyway, my question is, we as black people, are we being taken for granted by the Democratic Party? The reason I ask that is Hillary Clinton came to Las Vegas twice. And the community she spoke to exclusively was the Latino community. Personally, I have a problem with that. Now, yes, she's coming back and maybe she'll speak to somebody else, but again, we've been there. We've paid the price. Now, the second point is when we talk about incarceration, and I understand there's a difference between husbands and wives, but her husband signed the minimum maximum prison terms. So again, we need to be careful and look at the details before we just throw our allegiance to someone. And once again, welcome to Las Vegas.
Thank you very much. So that was a phenomenal question. So good, you're lucky. You might have got a hug for that too. So two things. I just first want to say, I should have recognized the other elected leaders in the auditorium. I started my career out as a city council person, and then was the mayor of Newark, New Jersey. And there is no harder job than being a local elected leader. Folks know who you are, they know where you live. The issues often are far more urgent. I'm new in the United States Senate. I've been there just a handful of months, been about a year and a half now. I'm so new I still have that new Senate smell, if you smell me. But it's so much different. The demands on me are so much different than when I was a local politician. And I just want to thank the local leadership that's here right now. You can definitely go ahead. So to be kind, gentlemen, I'm going to say two things. Before I talk about Hillary, I just want to talk to you about it as an African American who really gets frustrated that we often are, in my opinion, taken for granted. I really do have that feeling sometimes. It's just expected that the black community is going to fall into line. And I've had that resentment, I've had that resentment even when I was elected official of a majority black city. I wanted to hear my issues talked about. And I wanted to make sure that they weren't an afterthought, that they were going to be the lead issue. Because King used to say this, that African Americans have served the purpose of being a conscience of our country. And that in many ways, the issues and the rights and the entitlements that we enjoy now, many of them have come about through the labors of the African American communities with others. So that's where I stand. I'm with you. Don't just come here and think you got me. Tell me what you're going to do, and how far are you willing to go to the mat about it? Now, I'm going to be honest with you. There are times when I've talked to members of my own caucus in the Senate, which is a body that is not representative on gender, race, or religion. It's not representative of where our country is in terms of diversity. And I've had to talk to folks about the urgency of these issues and why aren't we putting them further ahead in our caucus. I want you to know that I feel you, I'm with you, and I agree. And folks in here need to be discriminating voters and begin to have conversations with your leaders that are really blunt, because other communities do that. And we should do it as well. So now let me just switch to Hillary for a second, let you know why I am a full-hearted supporter of hers. And it's because of just what I said. What are you going to lead with? What are you, when the going gets tough, and I've been in rooms now where compromises have to be made and things fall to the wayside, what are you willing to go to the mat for? And so when Hillary's people told me that her first policy speech was going to be about the broken criminal justice system, which profoundly disproportionately affects blacks, and she was willing to step out, as did Bill, and say that the 1964 crime bill, and not enough police light. But for them, the two of them, and by the way, that bill, and even things like the disparity in sentencing for crack cocaine, this is a family conversation here. Let's just tell the truth. Black folks were in favor of that just as much as white folks were. The Congressional Black Caucus was supporting that bill and the punishments on crack cocaine. So the 1994, you know, the 90s, I was a guy in college, but I just want you to know that a lot of folks were supporting that were black and white, and for Hillary and Bill to come out and say that that was a mistake, that to me shows a lot of courage. And then for Hillary to show me that, Corey, my first policy speeches are going to be about issues that disproportionately affect African Americans. One, about the criminal justice system. Two, about voting rights. Would you know what's going on? You know what's going on in North Carolina? Before the ink on the Shelby decision at the Supreme Court got dry, they were passing laws that were going to discriminate against minorities, against poor people, against college students. So I now feel fortunate that I've had a chance to sit down with Hillary to talk about these issues. And there's an old saying that my parents, when I first ran for office in the council, my mom said something to me. She said, "Boy, you need to knock on every door." And I was like, "Why do I need to do that? That's thousands and thousands of doors." And she said, "Because this old saying," she says, "who you are speaks so loudly, I can't hear what you said." And everybody in this room knows something about shaking somebody in their hand, looking them in the eye, and you can feel them. And in the communities particularly, in my opinion, that have been disrespected historically, we have a way of separating truth from fiction. We have a way of separating light from dark. And so I'm telling you right now, I'm not telling you you should be sold yet, but Hillary will be back to the state. I know she's going to talk to white folks, black folks, Latino folks. I have offered to be, I've offered since 2016 to Ms. Clinton and said, "Send me out wherever you want me to go." Because at the end of the day, now that I'm in the Senate and I see how our issues are dealt with, I want to have a president that's going to have my back, our community's back, and that's Hillary Clinton.
Senator.
Hello. What's your name?
My name is Barbara, and I want to welcome you to Nevada, and you'll find this is a weird circumstance for everyone here. I am from your state of New Jersey, and I lived in Philadelphia, and I lived in New Jersey for 40 years with my mother and father. I know the problems in New Jersey. I went to Catholic school there, and there is a lot of problems and things need to be solved. I worry, and I know you will do it. I have 7 grandchildren who I want to go to college. I want to be in an America where we're not black and white and black matters. I'm Italian. Italian matters also, okay? And Latinos. And I had the father like you, but he was Italian. And he knew my every move, and I knew about respect, which I think the kids have lost today. But I am so glad to be here. My mother, actually, who is 90 years old, talked me into coming out west because I have health problems.
And so the question
is... and the question is...
Go ahead.
You are going to go back to New Jersey and yes. Do everything you said, and I believe it. And I believe all of the people in Nevada have a problem, and all of your congressmen, senators, your governor, even though... I ain't that thrilled, but I mean, he is your governor and my governor. I am happy to be here, and I hope that all the people here understand we are the United States of America.
I think that's good. And can I follow up on that point?
So yes, go right ahead.
So, Barbara, thank you. So, I just want to say something because Barbara brings up a lot of passion and.
Oh, yeah.
Yes. So, 2 really quick things, Barbara, so I want to get as many questions in as possible. The first thing is, there's been a lot of controversy over the Black Lives Matter movement. And I just want to, let's just go back in time for a second. When we wrote our founding documents in America, please understand that They were, Native Americans were referred to as savages. Women weren't referred to at all. Blacks were fractions of human beings. And I don't care who you are. I always make this joke that you know, sometimes in life you gotta get ethnic on people. I don't care if you're Korean, you're Irish, you're Italian. Because I don't care what road you took to America, most of us have faced a lot of challenges. Some of you know that Irish need not apply signs that used to be out. Some of you remember the Know Nothing movement and how Catholics were so discriminated against that when John F. Kennedy was even running, that people questioned whether a Catholic person, how could a Catholic person be president of the United States? And so in many ways, sometimes when we affirm things like Black Lives Matter, people might interpret that as a disrespect to the struggles that I've had. And I understand where that circumstance comes from. But the one thing I want to say that's inclusive to this understanding is it is painful to me that we have a country right now that is persistently disrespecting a certain populations in ways that are agonizing. Like the fact that we're still struggling for women's rights in this country, that people are trying to roll them back. When we know what the data says about women's earnings, violence against women in this country is disrespectful. We know in this country right now that the violence against gay and lesbian youth is horrific in this country. Teen suicide amongst gays and lesbians is incredible. But inclusive of that, when you talk about what's happening with African Americans, and I'll give you just one great example of a study I just read that might bring this to point. They asked people to write the description of a drug deal. And everybody in the study, and there were racially diverse people, 95% of the people in the study described an African American.
Oh my God.
We know the data shows that the majority of drug dealers are not African American. And so unless we are willing as a country to begin to start having conversations about the value of African Americans, the worth of African Americans, the need to say that the equality of African Americans, then that's gonna be problematic. And the reason why I support the Black Lives Matter is not because it affirms in some way that other lives don't matter, but because that I am now sitting in 2015, and we still have a nation that through its policies and the racially disparate impact that we are beginning to see that we were still devaluing the equality of Black lives. And the last thing I'll say to that, is I love American culture. And one of the reasons why I love it, in fact, with me in Las Vegas right now is my best friend since fourth grade, a 6'8", large Italian guy, Chris Magaro. And I want to tell you, my best friend since fourth grade, and I never want to get to a post-racial society. Why? Because when I go to his house, I want the Italian culture, the Italian food. I love America, I can experience Korean food. I love America that I can experience Southeast Asian. I don't want to ever lose our racial diversity at all. And I love that. And so I want to be this is the sole place on the planet Earth that celebrates this kind of rich diversity. But this is what I also worry about our country, and then I'm done with this point, we can go on to a long line for me. Because we tend to get ahistorical in our country. What do I mean by that? This is such a serious point. Let me stand up for it. We tend to get ahistorical in this country, and we have a convenient amnesia about how we got to 2015. So let me just give you one policy vertical that is so important: housing. Now, a lot of us seem to forget when we talk about lots of inner cities, be it Detroit, Cincinnati, East St. Louis, Newark. Did that just suddenly happen without any historical thought at all? There was a whole bunch of poverty, densely packed in an area, minority neighborhoods. No, these were conscious federal policies up until the 1970s, where we had the federal government, who I represent, doing things that were so pulling wealth out of the Black community, and in a disproportionate way, awarding that wealth to other opportunities. We all know that, that a lot of people created wealth in this country through their homes. Well, FHA loans and things like that, that that allow that to happen, allow people those pathways, but they also redlined communities and devalued minority neighborhoods, making it very hard. The second federal policy is just where we put affordable housing. We have this, somehow this view that we're going to build all affordable housing in America, public housing densely packed in certain areas. I know the history of my state, towns like the one I grew up in. I moved to Harrington Park, New Jersey. My parents had to get a white couple to pose as us in 1969 so that we could buy a home because of real estate steering in those days. But suburban towns in New Jersey didn't want any affordable housing. And so it all got built in these dense areas. And I say some of those historical facts just to let you know that there's a lot about our country, from the GI Bill, which is one of the greatest programs in the world, in our country's history, rather, but it had a very discriminatory impact on African Americans who were denied a lot of the same benefits. So we forget that a lot of these processes that we praise or think of positively created the history that we live in now. And it's very important we don't lose those threads. And I will start answering questions a lot quicker. Please.
Okay, what's up? Let's go over here to you, Mr. Mitchell. Let's get your side, and then we'll come back.
That's Mr. Mitchell over there?
Mr. Mitchell, he's the
Mr. Mitchell,
he's
I'm sorry.
He's controlling the microphone.
I'm sorry, Mr. Mitchell, who are you talking
and
with?
That's Mr. Martin on this side.
And Mr. Martin, okay.
Well, welcome, Senator Booker, to Las Vegas. I am China Fraser. I live in Sun City, Anthem.
May I call you China?
Yes, you better, because Lemery is a really good friend of mine.
Oh,
by the
uncle.
Way, he said he was going to introduce you to my beautiful daughter. Anyway, I would like to say that I do have my Hillary for America group here from Sun City Anthem. We feel like we helped turn Nevada purple by working with the greatest generation in Sun City Anthem. So thank you all for that. Okay. So, I want to say, I have a question for you, then I want to say that when you had your book club thing out there, you know, my book club did read your book, The New Jim Crow, and I'm going to tell you, I'm so happy we did that, because when we read it, it was before your book club, we didn't even understand what the content was going to be, but I think that if anyone who hasn't read it does read it, you'll understand what's going on in America today with the war on drugs and how it all started. So I just want to make that announcement. Now here's my question. Earlier in your talk, you were discussing the fact that, you know, we've dropped in so many ways with all of the wonderful things that we made America great. And you talked about running the country more like a company, a corporation. And what it made me think about, and I want to get your take on this, is this real big, scary situation we have going on in the country right now with the Republican Party, and how there was a program on the other day, I don't remember what it was, but there was a press conference with Trump, and he was talking about, you know, how he's trying, wants to run the country like a corporation. And I think that he's getting a lot of attention because he's saying things that people want to hear about breaking out of the political system and really getting things done. And but the other hand, it feels like he is a showman. You know, he may not know, he may think it's he's going to be a king instead of like a politician.
So is that the question? Should we
so
go?
The question is, what is your experience of what's going on with that? And do you think it's going to pass? Or do you think that he's going to be an authentic candidate? Or what do you think is
so
going to happen?
So two things real quick. One is the best two books I've read on the criminal justice system this year. One is Just Mercy by Brian Stevenson, a beautiful, heartwarming, as well as painful book. And the second one is the one you mentioned, which is The New Jim Crow, which really details the brokenness of our criminal system in a way. It's almost, I think it should be required reading. And I thank you. If anybody follows me on Instagram, Twitter, or Facebook, I put a lot of this content up, and I have a book club, and I appreciate you doing that. The second thing is, look, this is the silly season in politics right now. This time, two cycles ago, Rudy Giuliani was leading. This time, one cycle ago, Michelle Bachmann was leading. Please don't take anything that's going on now as in any way a foreshadowing of what's going to come. It's just not going to be indicative. And I'm telling you, I know Donald Trump. He's in and around New Jersey a lot. I know his family. I have nothing disparaging I want to say about him whatsoever. I just want to let you know that this campaign has not yet even really begun, and you're going to see the leadership change. When it comes to values that are being run, to say corporate values means nothing to me, because there are some corporations that I love and think they have great values and represent some of the best of ideals, and there are some corporations that are depraved and treat their workers horrifically, in my opinion, and should be should elicit moral condemnation. What we really want is just leaders who have common sense, who are pragmatic, who, in my opinion, again, I've partnered, please understand, on criminal justice reform, my partners, because I look at this as a pragmatic way, I'm trying to get legislation passed, I have partners from Rand Paul to Ted Cruz, Grover Norquist, Newt Gingrich, have all come forward for different purposes maybe, but we've arrived at the same legislation. So please understand, I don't care about corporate or nonprofit. Good leaders are good leaders, and we should elect the greatest leader possible for our country. I've told you who I think that is.
Excuse me, before we take another question, we just like to know, we are pressed for time, so I want to make sure that all of our questions are being held, are being stated, I should say. And also, so if you can keep the questions down, and then also censor responses as well.
Thank you very much. My staff says I tend to try to give a dissertation every time I respond to a question. So we'll make a deal right now. I will be short if you are short. No statements whatsoever. We'll go question, answer, Q&A.
Thank you so much.
Welcome to Las Vegas, City of Brooklyn. I, too, am a pilot of New Jersey schools.
You, I owe you a hug, man. I'm not going to jump down because I told you to quit.
No, that's okay. I went to school in Trenton, in Newark. Here in Nevada, we have one of the worst school systems in the country. On the federal level, what are your suggestions that we can do to help better our school system? Education opens up the door.
So I think that we're talking about criminal justice system, reforms are needed, but the early conversation we need to have is what are we doing to prevent our kids from going down tough roads in the first place? And so just really quickly, because we can talk a lot more about federal education policy, but one, I think that we went too far with all this hyper-testing and all that kind of stuff. We need to move it back. So the federal government, stuff like that, we need to move it back. And the second thing, the best thing the federal government can do is invest in early childhood education.